We came in the bus from Derry, run by the Prisoners' Dependence Fund, so there was always a lot of us. Came initially when my first son got sentenced in November 76. There was just a hut, a wooden hut. There was no seats in it. And this was my first impressions of Longcash, was this hut and all these people standing. And standing for hours and hours and hours. And then some prison officer maybe poking his head around the door and saying, no visits for them naked boys. And that was November. December, you come up. I came up as often as I could, maybe. I think they said visits once a month, but those were conditional on prisoners putting on a prison uniform. I remember coming up with a priest one day, and they really humiliated him, and I think prison officers really went out of their way to humiliate us too as well. But standing in that wooden hut, maybe for 4 or 5 hours, and them coming out and just saying no visits for Nihilus. Trying to remember now, and my memory's not very good. We never got as far as going anywhere when he just went home again after the visit. And then I think in March 1977, I think the Archbishop of Fee was allowed in, or Feller Fall or something. And they actually allowed us a visit then once a month, 30 minutes once a month. And they kept you in this wooden hut, you still had to stand there. And then you went through search. No, before you, I'm way ahead of myself. You come in the turnstile. You went to an office with a parcel which nobody ever accepted of you. And you had to give your name and address. And I always said Derry. They used to say back to me, no, Londonderry, and I used to insist I live in Derry. So there was, my memories of it, there's always a conflict situation going on between myself and prison officers. Then you went in through search, and the search was very, very thorough. My memories of the search is that the people doing the search were just hostile people. They were like prison officers. You could almost feel or sense this hostility, you know, and you weren't never treated as if you were a human being anyhow. Then you went through into this other room then, and you waited there. And then your name was called, and everybody smoked. My goodness, the place would have been full of smoke. And you waited until your name was called, and you went out into a van with all these other people. And the van had darkened windows, so you couldn't see where you were going. You just drove somewhere. And you get out of the van and you came across a yard, something maybe like this here. This here doesn't, maybe came after my sons got out. And you went into another room there. And then you waited until you were called for your visit. That's my memories of it. It's not, it was, I just always felt really tense, even on the brightest day coming up this place. I always thought it was dark, And I was always tense. I always had nerves in my stomach. The only consolation that you had was maybe talking to other visitors. But very few people spoke in those visiting rooms. Everybody smoked, because I think everybody was feeling the same apprehension. When you actually were called for the visit and went into this visiting room, and they were talking at the beginning of the prison protest in 1976-77, you walked down this room with all these people who, at the beginning it was okay, I recognise my son, although the day that he was sentenced they shaved all his hair off. But after a while, they all looked the same. They had on these unshipply sort of trousers, or maybe navy, like denim jackets. And they all looked exactly the same. It's hard to find your own children, because after 1978, when the no-war began, my son had blonde hair, but that got dark. And you sat down at the table and you tried to be normal. Is that the word for it? You tried to act as if you were normal, is it? And you were sitting there in shock, and you didn't want your children to see the look on your face, because I remember sitting looking at Donoghue, and the lice would have been crawling up into the side of his hair, and I'd be sitting there, and every one of them had these white faces and these black sort of rings on their eyes, So you're trying to conduct, you know, house things, and you're trying to be normal. And there's about 7 or 8 prison officers standing around you, you know, listening to everything you were saying, watching everything you were doing. And because the situation was so bad, at the beginning, mothers, wives, sisters, everybody, we tried to bring in things. When, remember, there was I think it was the winter of 78, I think I. And the prisoners, it was a really bad winter, and the prisoners had escalated the protests, so they had broken all the windows in their cells, so they were cold. And Donna had told me that he woke in the morning and they were lying on the sponge mattresses. You know, worse, they were urinating and doing everything in their cell and spreading their faces in the wall. But he told me he woke and he was frozen to the floor. You know, it was cold. And things like that used to really drive me around the bend. I used to go home at night and have nightmares about it. The idea that any of your children, because, you know, really, I don't think you ever stopped being a mother, at least I never stopped being a mother, even if your children had grown up. And that was one of the strange things about this place here. That Donoghue was 18 when they came in here, John was 17, and 10 years or whatever later when they got out, they were still in my head, they were still 17, 18. I didn't see them sort of growing into manhood or changing. And they were still, you know, the 17, 18 year olds, and they were changing. But at that stage we were mothers like myself, we tried to bring in things that they needed, like their mice was all scabs, Donoghue's mice was all scabs. So they smuggled in vitamin tablets and side stretch and sailor. Smuggled in a bit of tobacco, just so the searchers knew. Smuggled in the tops of biros, or you smuggled in ciggy peppers and all those things. Searchers got very extreme. And a lot of us were getting pulled and told to go and sit in a certain. The member said to me one day, you and go in the box A or something, I think it was, box number one. She said that because you're a problem. And I wondered what that meant. What's a problem? Of course, the problem was that we were trying to make what was a situation of absolutely intense horror a wee bit easier for our own children, for the prisoners. Well, every visit was an absolute battle, you know, between ourselves and prison officers. And I think, I'm trying to remember when they started to allow in. The prisoners were never allowed anything, and from 1976 until after the hunger strike. So the battle was always just about, with the prison officers, was about your name and address and the permits and your ID, and you come from Derry now, you're from Londonderry now, from Derry, and that kind of stuff. And coming across the yard, you know, with this, I used to have this knot in my stomach, really awful tension. And the other thing was, everybody, I could look around me, the prisoners were so thin, they'd lost so much weight because they weren't getting proper food. So it was hard to even recognize it. And every month you saw them, you thought they were getting worse, and so they were, you know. But you would have come across that yard down there and through the turnstile and into the search room. See, at the beginning, there was no seats in it, but later on, I think they gave us another room with a toilet, which was great because that was another thing. You know, the facilities were so primitive. If they were punishing the prisoners, they were also trying to punish relatives as well. But when you went in to visit to your son, you never told. I never said anything to him. It was bad or unpleasant. I felt obligated. Because that's the wrong word. I just felt that I had to do something to try and alleviate the absolute horror that was facing me. You know, an 18-year-old who was grown old before your eyes, he was dirty, who you knew was going back to, you know. I remember one day watching him, you know, when they were taking him out, you know, down the room, and there was blood running down his legs. And I was that stupid, I couldn't think, how did he get the blood? Of course, I realised, I can't remember what time on, that he probably had a search of his anus on the way out, because that was the time they used to spread eagle them over the table and do these obscene searches, that's the only word they were. And of course, the female searches, they were also obscene. You know, the way they put their hands down your body and felt you and stuck their hand up your jumper, and I just felt they were really degrading, the way the search was, and then the threats, you know, are you carrying, they used to have this peculiar language, are you carrying anything on your person? You know, that's the way they didn't say to you, like Mrs. Nellis or whatever, are you carrying anything on your person, as if you were sort of nobody, and you would have said no, and they would said, well, you know, we can bring in the doctor from Lisburn and have you strip search and all that. And of course we were all carrying something in our persons. And I remember Christmas. I tell this story to everybody because one that I remember, and it's not a story, it's just an experience. But I remember Christmas, and I was in absolute desperation about what could you give your children for Christmas. Everybody outside was talking about Christmas and presents and all that there. And you were coming up to this absolutely horrible place here. And you couldn't give them anything. They weren't allowed anything. So I had tobacco and I had Turkish Delight. And of course I had Turkish Delight was square, but I had to make it into a cigar shape and put the stretching seal and I put it in my vagina, because that's the only way we could get things in when the searches get bad. And they caught the tobacco, but they didn't get the Turkish Delight. And when I got into the visit, I passed my son. And you should have seen me trying. It was another thing, you're trying to pass me notes and things, and all the screws stand watching you, you know. And you had to give your son big hugs and kisses and all this, and they would have been pulling you away. and I somehow managed to give him a Turkish delight, and he said to me, "What's that?" And I said to him, "It's Turkish delight." And he said, in the midst of this hurry, he had a great sense of humour. He said to me, "It's changed its shape since I was outside, you know." I mean, you could do nothing else but laugh about that, you know, but of course I wasn't laughing, but anyhow. And then he said to me, "What happened to the tobacco?" And I said, "I got caught." And he says, "I would rather have the tobacco, ma'am, sure he would have, you know." But you see, if he had said to me, and I'm sure all the other visitors, relatives, that were, if he said to me, "Bring me an M60, I would have done my best to get it done. You know, that's how it is. It was always this desperation kind of stuff, you know. I would have brought on anything he asked me to bring in, I brought in, and so did every other mother. And that was us trying to kind of take away their pain. So when we come outside that day, this Professor Brown pointed out to me this contrast, the flowers and the nice waiting room and then inside. But he also said to me, because I said to him, "I don't know whether any of these prisoners and my own sons of Clare will ever keep their sanity in this place." And he just said back to me, your son's all right." He said, "Do you notice how clear his eyes were?" And I said to him, "I hadn't even noticed his eyes. I was so busy looking at dirty hair and scabs and her white face." He said to me, "Your son's eyes is very clear." He says, "Look at the eyes of the prison officers. They're the people who are really the prisoners in here." I remember as well that man saying that to me that day. And it was, he probably has no idea how consoled I felt, you know, because I was so between their mental health and their physical health. And all everything else, I was so worried about it. John got arrested in 1978. Donna was then 2 years in the protest, and that was the time that the noir started. So poor John, only 17, he was 300 in this. And if I had two passes for the two of them in the one day, I would have had to come in and see whoever's name was in the pass first, maybe Donna. And then come in, go through the search, stand in the waiting room, go into the van, come down into the other waiting room, go in for the visit, and then come back out of the prison, into the van, away down, as if I was just coming in, and go through the exact same thing all over again to see John. And it was cruel, you know, for they never saw each other. Never, you know, only maybe an odd time in the visit they might have seen each other, you know, and that was why you would have tried to take, you know, you would have tried to, as much as possible to get other people to come to visit John or Donahue so the two of them might actually see each other passing, you know. But I remember one day, trying to think what happened. Sort of getting up. Oh, it was the day the Pope came. Good gracious, we'll ever forget that. I was part of a relatives group, and we had done a hunger strike ourselves a week before. You know, we'd done all these token hunger strikes maybe over a weekend. And we were hoping that the Pope would say something about this horrible place here. And I had a visit that Saturday. The Pope, I think, was at Drogheda or something. And I came up to see John, and I had some tobacco for him. And it was an awful visit for the screws. Actually saw me trying to pass him. The tobacco, I don't know what, and I had some wee note. I think he actually swallowed them or something. But then how they stopped the visit. It was only 15 or so, 20 minutes on the visit, and they stopped it. And I was beside myself. But we worry for him because knew they'd probably give him a beating on the way back, and beside myself too, they would get under the boards or all that. Because they, do you know what, they actually had prisoners on a bread and water diet. They used to put them down the boards on a bread and water diet. Something that went out, because I had told Fella Fall about that and he didn't believe me, and then he found out for himself, the late Monsignor Fall. And he said that sort of punishment went out 100 years ago. That, you know, they had no right, that what they were doing was totally illegal. But then everything they were doing in here was totally illegal, whatever. But then I came home, I was splitting a headache. I totally, everybody in the bus that day, it was an awful visit. And turned on the TV thinking the Pope will say something about here, but he never mentioned it. He absolutely never mentioned it, never. All he did was, remember, on my knees, I beg if you turn away from violence, all that. I don't know who wrote this speech or whatever, but he never said anything. And you see, when he died, Pope John Paul, and everybody in the world was talking about what a wonderful Pope he was and what a great man, I wasn't. Because that's what I remember about his reign as a pontiff. The fact that he came here, and he knew, because Monsignor Alibrandi, he was a papal nuncio. I used to go and visit him, both myself and Cathy McDermott, who's the mother of another prisoner, and we took him down. We supplied him with all the evidence, all the data that was going on about prisoners. So, and he would have passed them on to Pope. So I've never forgotten that, never. You know, the people that you expected, they do something or say something. And at that stage, even then, the prisoners would begin to talk about hunger strike, and it was scaring the heart out of the rest, because they were so thin and they were so emaciated, and they were, you know, Donna had told me the prison officers used to throw the food on the door of the cell. If it landed on the clean part, they ate it, and if it didn't, because it was all maggots and everything, they didn't. And nobody told me. He told me about the wee bird. He'd probably tell you all this himself if he wants to. A wee bird hopping on through the bars of the cell one day and jumping down and pecking at the food that was lying on the floor. And he says the bird was making a better job of eating the food because his lips were all stuck together with scabs than he was. He told me that. I don't forget them things. Feel about doing a job like this? How can you accept money for doing a job like this? It's absolutely degrading. And the one on the Crumlin Road, and I said to her one day, I said, see if you put your hands up my jumper again, I'm going to charge you with indecent assault. And she really is shocked, you know. We all should have done things like that. Some of the relatives, I've seen a woman coming out from visits in here, coming out the other end, the waiting room, crying in tears because of the way that they were searched. I've seen that myself. It upset them so much. I would have been upset, but I'd never let them see. I wouldn't cry about it. They love for their consciences. That they were part of it, but I can't think of anything worse. Concentration camps in Germany, talk away about that. Oh, Jesus, that's what this place was here. This place was nothing short of a concentration camp where prisoners were tortured, beaten, humiliated, and we relatives were nearly treated the same. And some prison officer would be made of the decency to stand up someday and tell people what they did in here. So far none of them have told anybody. Well, the No Arse protest, which began in 78, and the beatings and the plight of the prison. I mean, their health and everything just got steadily worse. And then they began to talk about, Donna had told me one day in a visit that there were some of the prisoners talking about a hunger strike. I remember sort of feeling this cold kind of feeling. We always were cold up here anyhow, but then this cold thing went down my spine. And I said to him, no, son, don't think about that. You know, at that stage in the Relatives Committee was quite powerful, and the National H Block Committee had been set up with Bernadette McAliskey and Maura McGrory and really great people on it, Valerie O'Doyle and all. And I think they were doing tremendous work, and of course we were too. We were tripping all over the country. I was standing in the Champs-Élysées in Paris with bare feet in a blanket, and that's the sort of things that the Relatives were doing. And we sent out a group to America, and the Washington Post picked up the story. And so I was telling them all this, you know, this is going to be the publicity. It's going to be too much of the British government. And of course, the British government were reacting all right, because I remember Humphrey Atkins, was it him? I think he came to Derry, and I remember they had the whole place cordoned off, but I'm very small, and there's all these big cops, and I went down underneath their legs, and I reached for him with a tie. You know, in the Belfast Telegraph, got a lovely photograph of me swinging on them before I got the shit bit out of me. But so you were trying to, I don't know where any other parents were, or sons were telling me, I don't know, but Donna had mentioned it. So every week I went up, I had told him about all these things that we were doing. His head must have been deaved listening to me. And it was desperation stuff, you know, was he feeling kind of desperate. But I did go up in the visit, and I'm just trying to remember when it was, but he told me that hunger strike was on the cards. And I didn't say to him, don't you do it. But every part of me wanted to say, don't you do it. Doesn't matter who else does, but don't you do it. Explained to me how difficult it was. He was very good at that. He was very mature for his, I suppose he grew up in prison. And he told me too, if it might be a bit divisive, and it was important that we kept the relatives together. He told me that. And then eventually then the word came out about the first hunger strike start. I went up to see Donna. He explained the reasons why they were going on hunger strike. And I totally accepted and wasn't going to fight or argue with him. You know, I wasn't going to say this is wrong, whatever had been done, all that. All said all the things about, don't just do that, let us do it on the outside. Because you realise how stupid you were. The prisoners always had a make the run, and we were just outside trying to do what we could, you know. And to tell you the truth, we were probably the weakest link in the whole kind of chain and stuff. And so I accepted what he was saying, and I suppose like every other mother, you just prayed, you know, that your son wouldn't be one of the people in hunger strike. But then you felt he actually gave me a note, a wee smuggled note. And he said to me, it's going to be very hard on relatives and parents, and try and make sure that, you know, you hold them all together. And if things get out of hand, read out this note to them. And it was a wee note really explaining, you know, that this was the prisoner's decision, that nobody else was influencing, that this was what they had to do to break this horrible kind of treatment that was meted out to them, and the British were showing no signs of relenting. Although somewhere, I think along the line, Humphrey Atkins did ask for a meeting with relatives, and I was one of the people that went to the meeting. I think Mrs. Bateson was there too, I'm trying to remember. But you knew that day talking to Atkins, and of course you had Thatcher too in the middle of it all, but you knew that they weren't going to move, they weren't going to do anything, they weren't going to change anything. The first hunger strike began, and I think that was a terrible time, but we were on the streets when we got up in the morning to be laid down at night. There wasn't a road or dairy, we didn't block, there was nothing that happened. We disrupted every facet of life that we could. I think probably the Brits had it all, knew that this was going to happen, so they were able to deal with it. And of course the media, there was nearly a media blackout. The first hunger strike ended, as you know. What they call them is dying. And the prisoners actually were given certain assurances. I went up to see Donoghue the next morning. He was still on hunger strike. He joined the first seven started the hunger strike in October, and then every week so many more joined. So I think Donoghue had joined on the next group, and so did the woman in Armagh, for the woman in Armagh, including Mairead Farrell. When I went up the morning after, that was a Friday, I think, the morning after the first hunger strike ended, I had a visit. I remember as well, there was snow on the ground. They had to get snow plows to clear the glenshane. And when I went down to see Donoghue, there was absolute uproar in the case that morning. He was still in hunger strike because they didn't know what was happening. There was no communication with the prison officers. They probably just making sure there wasn't. And they didn't know whether the woman and her ma were still in hunger strike. And so as far as he was concerned, the hunger strike was still going on. The first hunger strike ended, and there was an absolute awful confusion about what demands of the prisoners had been granted, you know. And oh, the other thing was there wasn't any indication from the British. And I was talking to Father Fall that they were going to give the prisoners their demands, but there had been papers apparently exchanged. So we assumed that their clothes would be part of that. So it was coming up the Christmas period, I think, just after the first hunger strike ended. So we went up with the clothes. No, it was January, that's right. The word came out that they would be allowed clothes, so everybody was so delighted. You rushed out and you bought the best clothes, was going, trainers, whatever you could, because you hadn't had clothes in 5 years or 6 years. So we all went up with the clothes, and I remember that day at the parcels office. I handed in the clothes. Your man looked at the family, Nealis. I says, he's not a conforming prisoner, that's what they call it. He's not getting them in. I said, they're allowed in their clothes now. Who told you that? He says, I said, you sent us. I can't even remember how the word came out. No, I'm not getting them. Yeah, they weren't to the clothes back of this. I'm not getting them. Well, they were there. They have clothes on here, prison uniforms. And they had brought on all their clothes. I don't know where the hell they got them, that they wanted them to wear. Prisoners wouldn't wear them anymore, and they would wear the uniform. So that following week, Derry City Council was having their annual meeting, and I went down. I stormed into the council meeting with a group of other women, mothers and wives, and the mayor was sitting up in his chair, and I went up and wrapped a pair of men's underpants around his neck. And I said, the council, people are going to let, the prisoners are going to die because of men's underwear and socks, and you're going to let those prisoners die. And in case, I was absolutely beside myself at that stage, you know, just couldn't believe that the Brits had gone back, and whatever concessions or whatever word that they had given to people like Fallerfall or whatever, and they wouldn't allow the clothes in. Imagine. And that's why there was a second hunger strike. That's why Bobby Sands died, and Mickey and Ray McCreation, all of them. That's where they all died.